Bashar Assad, and of course the party, the ruling party, that provides the guidance to the government in every sense of the word. Mr. Bilal was also, at the time that I was there, he was a very popular, and if you don't mind my saying so, also a very flamboyant Minister of Information, a very popular Minister of Information. And of course, all that, you know, his political background hides the fact that he was also a very successful medical practitioner and a surgeon, and in fact, you know, an academic, a medical academic in his own right, so to say. You know, but I think there is a special pleasure in welcoming you, Excellency, here, not just because of your personal qualities and profile, which of course are brilliant, but also because what Syria, and what your government stands for, has historically stood for, a very principled and independent foreign policy that has supported just Arab causes, particularly the Palestinian cause, that has supported the rest of the developing world in the anti-colonial struggle, and secondly also for withstanding an extraordinary amount of international pressure over the last 8-9 years, of a kind that is almost unparalleled anywhere in the world, at a time when a number of countries were trying to force regime change and actually put together a coalition of willing parties to try and destabilize Syria, taking advantage of the what was called the Arab Spring. On completely false pretexts, I think Syria has been able to show a lot of resilience and a lot of strength. The institutions have held, the army has held, the government has held, and with the help of parts of the international community, in particular I would say Russia, has been able to recover from a fairly difficult situation around 2015, not at all helped by many of the other major powers in the world. But today we face a prospect where Syria is about to hopefully recover its full sovereignty, territorial integrity, and of course its rightful place in the world. As we look ahead, we also face a very strong requirement for reconstruction of Syria. We realize that Syria also is under sanctions. Your visit in that context is very timely. We've had recently a tweet from President Trump, which effectively allowed Turkey to act as a kind of aggressor in northern Syria. A little small part of Syria is still under control of extremists. Syria has also stood for religious pluralism and with the border with Turkey. Also has always stood by the principles of religious pluralism and religious moderation and, you know, anti-extremism. In fact, if you don't mind my saying so, in 2008, when President Bashar visited India, he made a remark to our leadership, which is probably worth reminding people now, because he told us that Syria and India stand at two ends of an arc of fundamentalism. We should cooperate to prevent that growing from now. I don't know how well we heard him, but certainly that truth has come true, not just in West Asia, and Syria and Iraq have borne the brunt of it, but also in very large parts of South Asia. So it was a very prophetic remark that he made at that time. Excellency, I don't want to keep you, come between you and the audience. I think that you have a very good crowd and a very learned crowd present here, lots of very senior journalists as well, who are keen to listen to you. While of course they'll be very keen to hear about the dynamics of our bilateral relations, I'm sure they would like to know much more than that. They would like to know more about Syria today, about the international pressures it has faced and survived, and also the internal political prospects of a solution. Thank you.
Thanks, Mr. Bilal. Thanks. My dear friends, my dear brother, here with me, our own ambassador, also my colleague and my relative. He is from Tartus, from the same city of mine, and he was deputy minister, external minister. He was ambassador. He was a professor in Damascus University, Al Fatah Amura. So, and now I don't know why India gained him and attracted him to stay here. In spite of, India has very large popularity in my country and love and attraction. Everybody in Syria talking to India. You consider yourself as Indian. So it means wise man, it means very well cultured, etc. So, and the ambassador, they know very well how much our Syrian people loves India and the Indians, really. So, and I feel very proud to come finally to India and to talk directly and to see directly the wonderful Indian people. And I found a lot of in common between us as Syrians and the Indian population. In spite of in our Middle East, they are talking always about Islam and the principles of Islam, etc. But inside of them, they are secular people. Mike Abshata, in spite of everybody talk about Islam, principles of Islam, but inside of him, yani, you can see very transparent man, very well-cultured man, and inside, really inside, secular. In spite of he is talking the Quran, the principles of Quran, etc., but you can see in the Syrian citizen a kind of love for others, tolerance for others, talking with very good and educated manner. So I feel proud to be one of them. And I am not so deeply a good Muslim, but in the same time, I feel very secular. I feel to be a human, like any human man in this world. I share with him the pleasure, the sadness, the delicate senses. So I do not feel to be Muslim so very well. مبشر في الجنة يعني ما عادي مثل هالعادي يعني normal man, normal citizen, etc. In 2011 Syria was bombarded (inter parentheses) by that enemies of humanity, the so-called terrorists, the so-called Islamists, the so-called fanatics, and they came from all over the world, even from France, even from London, even from Latin America, from Chile, for example. They were militants from Chile, the last country in the world, very, very far from Damascus. So they came in name of Allah, in name of God, to fight the enemies of Islam, to fight and to rebuild a new country as good Muslim, good mu'min, and etc. So, and they started a kind of eliminations of the best heads in the country. Eliminate them physically. In that time, because somebody, some pseudo-intellectual, started to make a word of, we are fighting to renew Syria, to re-put democracy on the country. So we have had two currents. First one They fight for to put the country on the road of Allah, of good Islam and pure Islam, etc. The other side, the other current, they were fighting for democracy, for participation to rule the country, etc. And then, after months, they divided. This kind of coalition between that kind of people, one current fighting for the new Islam or for the old Islam, the other side for the new democracy, etc. So, at least they fought against themselves. The destruction in my country, yani, were terrible. In Damascus, in Homs, in Aleppo, in do you remember Salamiye, Hama, etc. So Dirzor, Raqqa. So, yani, it is when we remind such moments, because that history since 2011 till 2016 or 18, it was a horrible situation. Because the other side, the other current, yani, civic one, secular one, they out. That the guys who deeply involved in the crime, they were the so-called Islamists, Al-Qaeda, or now the new generation of Daesh, and Nasra, Jabhat al-Nasra, and other yani, current Jahiyat Tahrir al-Sham. Yani, it was some of black days and moments for the whole Syrian people in that time. I am with Professor Amoura. We are from Tartus on the Mediterranean Sea, far from Damascus, about 2,070 kilometers. 270 kilometers. Yeah. A lot of times, from the middle of the distance, our soldiers invited us to come back home, because the street is, the rest of the road is so dangerous, so very good. So they were black and horrible and sad moments for our people, for our universities, for our institutions, for everybody. 2015, 16, 17. I cannot explain how our ex-friends in France, Britain, United States, in Germany, how, in any, yani, in which principle to be beside of that horrible, dangerous, yani, terrorist. How, yani, a democratic republic like France and ex-colonial for Syria to be behind terrorists who destroy Syrian building, housing, etc., and kill the Syrian citizens, students, professor, technician, etc., and to be
backed by Republic of France. It was horrible to think about. Horrible. United States to back such kind of people for getting some tank of petrol in the east of Syria. A lot of principles violated in the war, Syrian war against terrorism. Really, we discovered, like a physician who discovered suddenly the diagnosis of his own patient. How? In which manner? In which principle? In which law? A terrorist came from, I don't know from where, from all over the world, paid by some of Gulf countries and assured for him the transit by Istanbul, by Turkey, and backed in Security Council in the United States, in the United Nations. It was some incredible situation at that time, in spite of all that situation, black situation, horrible situation, in the United Nations. We thank our friend Russia and China. They used the right of veto. If not United States and Europe, they were voting against Syria to destroy it, like 2003, when destroyed Iraq by United States. As Syrian, we were in the same situation, I believe, to suffer the destroying of our country and destroying of us, physically. So we decide to defend our dignity, our physical entity, and our home. And we did. Thanks God, thanks the determination of our people, thanks the solidarity with us, countries, honorable countries like India, like other countries in the world, in Latin America, in Far East, etc. So thanks to Russia, to Iran, to a lot of organizations and personalities and journalists and men of brain and think, etc. They backed us, and we are thankful for them, for all of them. And we saved our country. We save ourselves also. Because in Syrian, Mr. Ambassador, Tartus,
yes,
and the Latakia, and etc. May and Abd Fattah, we are from Tartus. Now you can have how many widows, how many orphans, a kind of horrible situation. But we saved our country. This is important. Of course, the surprise was how a country like Turkey to make a bridge to transfer and to assure the terrorists coming from Europe, from North Africa, from Latin America, and to come through Turkey, and the Turkish authority recommend their own dignity, physical integrity, until to arrive to Aleppo or Syria or Idlib, etc. Idlib now, till now, yani under the control of terrorists. That bridge, the terrorist speaking, gave the permission to the U.S. forces to occupy some Syrian province and to occupy specifically the fonts of petrol and the generator of electricity by the Euphrates Dam, who gives Syria the whole electricity. Now the American forces control Euphrates Dam, controlling the petrol, and himself, President of United States, said, yes, yani, we need such $35 million at month. Can you imagine a member of permanent of UN Security Council, the hugest country, to explain and to declare who is as Steve robbing, stealing the petrol of others, a sovereign nation, $35 million monthly. Instead to come to our balance Syrian, now yani, they are stolen by the others, by the government of the United States after the declaration of President Trump. So we have the province of Idlib. Idlib is a very small province in North Syria, arriving till the border with Turkey and with the Mediterranean Sea and the close to Aleppo. When Azar's province in Syria, we go through to conclude the terroristic war in such province, as example in Homs, in Deir ez-Zor, etc., who has capitulation of the, what do you want? What do you want, to die or to go to the border? To go to the border with Turkey, Idlib. Now we have such, yani, concentration of the terrorists in that last province of Syria. Now everybody talking about how to save that wonderful people in terrorists, in killers, criminals. Now everybody in the world, except India, talking about how to save such criminal people in that province. We are not in a hurry, but we have to arrive to honorable solution to get back such province to our own sovereignty. The element who is doing bad, and we feel very sad to have such neighbor like President Erdogan to behave yani like a para-terrorist. Yani, excuse me for this term, because we worked in diplomacy and etc. But really, I cannot find another term how to be president elected for a nation beside of another nation to encourage terrorist criminal who destroyed Syria, who killed thousands of Syrian young people and the military and the civil and etc. We are asking ourselves, from which matter President Erdogan made. The situation now, if somebody asks me, and no, then how to conclude? We have patience. We are patient people, but not forever. We have to conclude. We have to reget our own country, our own territory. Then the situation now, we have 2,000, 2,500 U.S. Soldiers in Al-Asad al-Furat al-Dirsur. Then we have on the north line border a Turkish army forces, and we have the block of terrorists in Idlib. This is the picture in Syria now, in this yani honest picture, without any making up. This is the truth, full truth. How to re-get free our country is now our debate. How to save souls from all sides, it's good. How to finish with the occupations, foreigner occupation like American and Turkish, that kind of questions, I think it is the matter of our here a debate between ourselves. If you can help us to find solutions, to find answers, it's yeah, it could be very useful, not for Syrians, for everybody. So before to conclude, we thank a lot India and the people of India, who is listening, looking with careful eyes and careful ears to know more, to see more, and then to decide how to move. We need to move because a part of our country is occupied by terrorists from one side and by countries from other side, Turkey and the United States, as example, and some yani French soldiers with the American in that province. So I got a lot from your time. I prefer to make a debate because to be useful for us as Syrians. And at the same time, we could have a full picture about the situation in Middle East, which is a very interesting and dangerous.
Thank you. Thank you, Excellency Dr. Mohsen Bilal. Before I go further, I just want to also welcome Ambassador, now Professor Amura. And I would also like to thank the Indian Council of Cultural Relations for facilitating your visit as part of its Distinguished Lecturers Series, Visitors Series, and also particularly to the Indian Council of World Affairs for hosting it and for providing the venue, as also the audience this afternoon. Excellency, before I throw open the floor, may I just ask a couple of questions to set the ball rolling while people also formulate their questions. I think one question is, you know, at the time that I was there and when Ambassador Haran was there, we are talking about 2009-10, actually Syria-Turkey relations were very good. And even the personal relations with personal relations between President Erdogan and President Bashar were also very good.
It's true.
What happened between 2010 and 11? that A, Turkey turned so hostile and so difficult, and also to a certain extent that a lot of countries around Syria ganged up in many ways, some physically, some through money, some through ideology, some through, as you said, providing transit, ganged up against Syria and President Bashar. And I say this because at the time that we were there, in fact, Syria was opening up.
Well, but what I like with the Mustafiz bin Agar. Yes.
Shall I continue?
Go on. No, no, no.
Syria was opening up. It was liberalizing. It was liberalizing politically. It was liberalizing economically. Foreign investment was coming up, coming in. Tourism was developing. New hotels were coming up. And I think something that we all know, Syria is virtually an open-air museum. Any part of Syria you visit is 3,000 to 5,000 years old. And there's such a lot of historical and cultural wealth in that country. We call it, a friend of ours or a senior Indian writer wrote a book called In an Antique Land. In an Antique Land is a perfect description of Syria. It's like a, you know, people talk about cradle of civilization. Syria is a cradle of civilization.
Thank you.
What made this international community and particularly Turkey go against Syria so badly? And the second question, because I think everybody will have this in mind, how do you assess your relations with India historically, but particularly during the period after 2011? Was India a good friend, and in what way? How was it a good friend for Syria? What are the ways in which we supported you? We are aware, you know, scholarships and so on, but we would very much like to see your assessment. After this, I will throw open the session for questions from the floor. When you ask your questions, please introduce who you are so that our chief guest is aware of it. And also, please don't have very lengthy preambles. Try to get to the questions as quickly as possible. And any questions, Mr. Bilal has said he's very open to questions, but please, all questions should be respectful.
Thank you.
تمام وكانوا اصدقاء الشباب شو صار
ما في شك يعني أنا I am sorry because I have to talk in Arabic because it's delicate questions so you can help me from the embassy so ما في شك إنه نحن دوما بعد ما إجا الرئيس بشار الأسد حط لحاله خارطة إنه تحسين الوضع مع الجيران.
Absolutely, Ambassador, what you have said is exactly what was happening in Syria ever since the President Assad have taken power in Syria in 2000. He wanted to have a new vision for Syria and especially having a good neighborhood.
بالنسبة لسوريا الجار يعني الضليع كان الجار الشمالي في الشمال اللي هو يعني قرب حلب واللي بحدود
950 كيلومتر
بحدود 900 كيلومتر
نعم
على المتاخمة بيننا وبينهم في الشمال السوري والجنوب التركي.
Because one of the major neighbor for us was Turkey. As you know, we share 950 kilometers of border with Turkey and the whole northern part of Syria. So therefore, he was looking for a good relation with Turkey in particular.
عندنا مشكلة نحن كبلد كسوريا. سوريا خليط من كل الأديان وسوريا عموما بلد علماني.
As you know, Syria is a multicultural and multi-ethnic societies, and also we have also a secular constitution.
وهناك في صراع على سوريا. اسمه الصراع على سوريا.
We always call it there's a conflict on Syria. We've been targeted by different vested interest nations.
وفيه منظمة يعني دينية إسلامية متعصبة اسمهم Muslim Brotherhood الإخوان المسلمين. واللي قياداتهم يعني موجودة في أوروبا في ألمانيا في إسبانيا في بريطانيا.
We have been targeted mainly by the extremist Islamist group which is called the Muslim Brotherhood organization. Have bases in neighboring country as well as in Europe.
وحددوا إنه هيدي سوريا بهالخلطة هاي ما عاجبتهم بدهم يعملوا حكم إسلامي ما بدهم حكم بقى.
So they didn't want a secular Syria because they never liked multi-ethnicity of the society, multi-religious. They wanted to make only one color, a Syrian, a hard Muslim country.
الرئيس أردوغان
Islamic State.
انتخب مؤخرا chairman, honorable chairman للحركة الإخوان المسلمين بالعالم.
Erdogan, the president of Turkey, he was elected as the honorary president of the Global Muslim Brotherhood Organization recently.
وكان بوده أن يستغل هدول الإسلامويين يعني المتعصبين هالشباب بتونس بمصر بليبيا إنه يهدموا الأنظمة هناك ويستلموها الإخوان المسلمين.
So he wanted to get the help from all these hardcore extremists available in all the regional countries neighboring Syria and the northern African state, where he wanted to use those Islamist forces, he called them, to reach his own objective while to take the lead, as he called himself, the de facto Khalifa of the Ummah.
كانت النتيجة إنه destruction لليبيا كاملة.
So that is why if you look at what happened to Syria, it was a total destruction.
Destruction لنص تونس.
It was devastated destruction even inside Tunisia.
Destruction لمدن كبيرة في سوريا.
In Syria also had been lots of ravage.
كانت هذه الدعوة كارثية.
And this call was really it was a catastrophe.
بمصر بيعرفوا كلهم شو حدث.
In Egypt, in Libya.
فنحن في سوريا.
We in Syria.
وكل الشعب السوري هو حدا يفكر انه والله الحكم في سوريا هو اللي قام وقف الحكم بسوريا قام وقف عبر الشعب السوري.
So please do not mistaken that it is not only one color of the Syrian society stood with the President Assad, not at all. The whole Syrian society have stood together to fight the aggressions that have been imposed on Syria.
نحن عنا شهداء من كل الألوان السورية.
We have martyrs from all religious group inside Syria. We have they have been killed.
Muslim كمان بالسكت تبعه مليون ألف شهري. كلهم دفعوا شهداء.
Everybody paid with his own blood.
للدفاع عن سلامة سوريا وسيادة سوريا والوضع السوري البلتي كلر.
Yes, as a country, as a whole country, for every Syrian.
الإخوان المسلمين عندهم حلم إن هذه المنطقة يعني مصر سوريا تونس ليبيا هالدول هاي العراق إلى آخره إنه هاي يضموها تزبط مع تركيا تركيا باعتبار أردوغان هو القائد العام هو تشيرمان تبع الإخوان المسلمين في العالم فبتكون هذه البقعة يعني very important area وتكون كلها يعني مسلمة.
So Ottoman Empire, they have Mr. Erdogan having ambition, as he called himself the Ummah Khalifa, and he wanted to regain the glory of the Ottoman Empire. So therefore, he think that by bringing together these countries and the North African states of the Arab world and Syria. And the neighboring country under his umbrella, he may be able to return the glory of the Ottoman time.
هلا كل زعماء الإخوان المسلمين بالمنطقة والسوريين.
And that's the objective and ideology of the Muslim Brotherhood.
عند أردوغان. ساكتين.
All of the hardcore extremists from the group are really residing in Turkey currently.
نحن بسوريا كناس سواء كنا فلاحين أو عمال أو أساتذة جامعات. أو أطباء أو مهندسين أو صيادلي أو بكل فئاتنا في المجتمع السوري نحن عم نشعر بفخر إنه استطعنا أن نحمي بلدنا ونحمي سيادتنا و يعني
we Syrian irrespective
of
our ethnicity religion background we as all the strata of the Syrian society feel proud that they have been able to steadfast this aggression, were able to stand and defend the country and altogether united to fight this menace of terrorism from our neighbors.
لاحظوا هالآلية اللي كنا نعملها مثلا حلب تنضرب حلب وجامعة حلب نجيب طلاب حلب إلى دمشق تنضرب مثلا جامعة حمص نجيب أولاد حمص نعمل لهم امتحانات ونعلمهم في دمشق
Just to give you one of the example how we retain our free and compulsory education in Syria. As you know, Syria has a free and compulsory education till the 9th standard. If you have a child between the age 5 to 7, you don't send him to school, you go to jail. Both the parents go to jail. So to retain that teaching in Syria, when they used to attack Aleppo or Homs, The people, the student, are giving exams. The government used to make sure to transfer them to Damascus, give their exam and return back them to their native city.
دمروا حلب القديمة, دمروا حمص القديمة, بينما تركوا دمشق القديمة ما دمروها الإرهابيين. فعندما سئلوا إنه ليش دمشق القديمة ما عملتوا فيها مثل حمص ومثل حلب, قالوا لأنه هون بناها المسلمون هيدي دمشق القديمة الجامعة المعدنية, بينما هناك اللي بنوها غرباء.
See, can imagine the ideology and the thinking of these people and their mindset that they said why they have destroyed the old city of Aleppo, the old city of Homs, while they retained the old city of Damascus. And the answer was that the old city of Damascus was built by the Umayyad, by the Muslim, but the northern part of Syria, Aleppo and Homs, was not built, was built by the Christians and by the other people groups. And the strangers, as you call it.
So, يعني كانوا هدول عنصريين ويعني أي تعايش معهم كان.
So they're extremists. It's very difficult to survive and live with them. That's the whole idea of the extremists in the Muslim Brotherhood. That's why they were banned in Syria as well.
بينما الدول ما يسمى بالدول الكبرى بالمجلس الأمن اللي لهم حق الفيتو, الولايات المتحدة الأمريكية, بريطانيا, فرنسا, كانوا يصروا علينا بدهم إنه ندان لأنه نحن عم ندافع عن القيم الإنسانية وهوديك, بدهم الاحتكار والتعصب والتوحش.
هلا بنحكي عن سؤال ثاني نهائيا. هذا آخر شيء. What's surprising was the Security Council's members, in particular France, United States, and UK, were fighting to condemn Syria, while Syria was fighting to uphold the values of humanities, coexistence, the other religious minorities in Syria, protecting every Syrian, and they are giving support in the United Security Council to the terrorist organization.
والدولتين الوحيدتين من الخمسة الكبار اللي كانوا يستعملوا الفيتو هن الصين وروسيا, لأنه فعلا علمانيين هدول يعني.
So Russia and China were the only two countries were supporting Syria and the Security Council.
السؤال الثاني عن العلاقات الهندية السورية.
هيدا يعني of course من لما كنا أطفال ما خلطنا ونحن عايشين ونتابع الوضع في الهند كما نتابع الوضع في دمشق. نحن أولاد الساحل.
As you know, from our childhood, we have a very good and cordial relation. Indian policy is like a domestic policy inside Syria. We discuss it, debate it in school, in colleges. We quote Indian leaderships, like we quote Jamal Abdel Nasser and other our leaders of the local Assad and all.
كنا نعرف جمال عبد الناصر مثل ما بنعرف جواهرلال نهرو مثل ما بنعرف تيتو, يعني اولادات كنا. So بس كنا عايشين على هالمجد هذا.
We grown up with the
لما
name,
كانوا زعماء عدم انحياز.
All these leaders were together.
باندونغ وهالدنيا, يعني الهند ومصر وسوريا الوحدة كانت جمهورية.
Because we were united with Egypt, so you had Syria and Egypt
يعني
was one. So
كانت بالنسبة لنا أن الهند
movement.
A domestic policy. يعني.
Yes.
So we كيف بنحكي بالقاهرة وبدمشق؟ كنا نحكي هيك.
We had that much of cordial relation we had with India, so you can imagine this is something very close with.
يعني أنا لو سألتوني ليش بنحب الهنود أنا ما بعرف, لأنه نحن ولدنا ضمن أسر تحب الهند.
See, if you ask me even why we love India, I don't know. I mean, to be grown up in a country and families, we love the Indians. We don't know why. Nobody knows. Every part of the Syrian family, seriously,
كل عائلات الشعب السوري بيحبوا الهنود.
They love Indian. They don't know why. He said, "This is a part of our life."
عبد الفتاح عمورة من بلدي وقريبي من طرطوس. لك هذا كان زعيم بسوريا, نائب وزير الخارجية وسفير بالأردن وسفير ما بعرف وين, ما بخلى صنعة إلا كان توب فيها. راح هلا وجاي ومتزوج بنت أرقى عائلات سوريا, تارك بناته وأولاده ودنيا جعلن.
He's leaving his own as a deputy minister and the ambassadors of Syria, and he was teaching at the university. And from very close, good family of his Mr. Mohsen friend, yet he left everybody behind, and he's all by himself in India. You ask him why he's in.
لكم نحن مسألوا لك ليش أم شيء عن ما بعد هلا هلا بدي جاوبنا.
Just to confirm, you know what the Dr. Bilal has said just now. I have been here now after I retired and came to join for almost more than 4 years. They always ask me, why you are in India? Simply because I love India.
Very good, wallahi.
بعد 2011.
نحن
مشينا 2011 لل 2016 تقريبا ونحن كنا في ظلام فظيع وفي
See, we had a really dark period of Syria was from 2011 till 2015
كنا نشعر بالهند انه هيدا الاخ الكبير اللي ممكن يستراح على زنده
We always looked at India and we can bank on India and Indian you know being supportive to our cause of the Syrian people
وعمر الهند ما خذلت سوريا
And they have never disappointed us the Indian
ونحن الان نركز اكثر مع الهند حتى نعلم كمان اطفالنا المدرسه الهنديه بالتسامح وبالتعايش بين كل الناس كل الخلق موجود بالهند
So that is why we have looked at looking east policy our first aim is toward India we want to learn to be taught the Indian values and the life the dharma way of life in India it has to be taught to our children and how to survive in a tolerance and a multi society and a diverse society like India
India for us it's a kind of example of life how to live how to live peacefully in the future for us India the example
ودعمنا لنا بالمحافل الدولية
بالضبط فالمهم نحن الآن أريح من الـ 2011 و12 و13 و14 لحد 15
So India have always supported us even in the international meetings and all they have supported that there is no foreign intervention in Syrian affairs as well no military intervention in the internal affairs of any country as per the UN charter
ولذلك نحن لما ارتحنا شوي من هدول الوعوش لوين توجهنا على الهند
So that is why when we start gaining retaking our territory back from those terrorists those savage terrorists inside Syria we are looking for India for help to rebuild Syria as well
يعني نحن جيلي انا كان يتطلع وين بده يتعلم يعني يتعلم بفرنسا ببريطانيا بايطاليا بالولايات المتحده وعملناها كلها مني وجر وانتم كلكم هو عبد الفتاح الكل الان الشباب السوري بيتطلع نحو الشرق
So our generation, when we grown up, we finished our school, we were looking for to further our study in Europe. We did everything, all of us, our generation studied in Europe. While we look at this new Syrian generation, wanted to study in India. And that's why you have the maximum number of Syrian students for the last 5 years you have an Indian or Syrian student.
يعني بالأول واحد منا كان يتطلع يصير سفير بباريس مثلاً, بلندن, بروما. الآن الشرق كله ما كان محطوط على البال الآن المحظوظ مثل أخونا رياض إنه يجي على الهند سفير أمير يعني
So I'll sum it up for you. Everybody had that trans Yamuna water. That's why they are coming back to India.
so much. I think, in fact, your beautiful Arabic needed no interpretation because the language was the language of the heart.
Thank you.
That's and true. I think we also respond Thank and we appreciate you. And Thank we, I think, you. Can sure. understand that Thank language you. Of the heart.
Sure.
So I think we have about 15 minutes for discussion. The floor is open for questions. Please, I'll single you out. Introduce yourself, please.
I'm Air Marshal Nohbar. I'm the Director General of Center for Air Power Studies. It's an Air Force think tank in Delhi. And one very basic question. Are you looking at boots on the ground from India in Syria to help you? That means military forces or like under you know auspices of the United Nations Peacekeeping Force? Are you looking at that? Because for India, in your country, there are two opposite camps. One is Russia-led, one is the United States. And both, we have got engagements. So it's going to be, we are going to be walking on very, very tricky ground, very slippery ground there. Because you will not be, we will not know whom, if we are forced to use, under Article 7, we are forced to use arms, we will not know whom to fight. So if you can just explain.
Incidentally, we are already there with the, in the Golan Heights.
Yeah.
Of course, the protagonists are different. But we already have a peacekeeping force.
The American or Yugda ضمن البند السابع للمتحدة لأنه روسيا وأمريكا كل واحدة من طرف اثنينات عم يقاتلوا بسوريا لذلك هل ممكن يكون دور للهند بوجودها في سوريا؟
بالجولان يعني؟
قوات كقوات.
إيه إنه بالعرض جولان ولا؟
لا كقوات في الأرض.
نحن هلا
خالصين.
ما طرحنا الموضوع هذا إطلاقاً.
We have no boat on the ground for anybody. We have nothing, and we do not expect any foreign troops inside Syria at all. We do not call for them.
أن قوات تركيا أن تعود لبلدها والقوات الأمريكية الفرنسية أن تجد.
As you know, we have liberated more than 85% of the Syrian territories, and as he was saying that only the northern part of Syria, northern eastern part, including Idlib, is left under the terrorist and the American invasion and Turkey. So you just have to clean it. There is nothing
else.
We will never have in our mind that anybody can a military intervention in Syria.
نحن بدنا الفول سوفرينيتي. على أرضنا كاملة.
Totally
reconstruction.
Yes.
I think that's a very important point. It's our very patriotic feeling.
Invited cordially.
Yes, cordially invited in reconstruction of Syria.
So there was a second question from that side. Please, madam.
Totally.
Ambassador, thank you. Minister sir, thank you. My name is Anushka Saxena. I handle public diplomacy for a youth-led organization called Global Youth. My question is, what is the future of the Kurds of Anatolia? Where do they establish their small minority, in Syria or in Turkey, and especially when the US officials have pulled back their support? Thank you.
Thank you for your question.
We never had a problem with the Kurds.
We had the
Prime Minister was a Kurdish. We had a Kurdish. We had a minister. We had a diplomat.
Problem with Damascus.
We had ambassadors. We never had a problem with
them. The problem is how they live inside of Turkey.
The actual problem is not the Kurd of Syria. It's the Kurd how they are surviving in Turkey. There where they have been prosecuted by the Turkish government. There is a racist attitude toward them. That is why they have been expelled and Syria received 300,000 refugees.
وفيه مشكلة كمان عند الرئيس أردوغان إنه كيف هو بيعتبر حاله good Muslim وإنه يكون بنفس الوقت عنصري يعني.
He is having a, you know, what we call schizophrenic personality, Mr. Erdogan. At one side, he doesn't know how to differentiate that he called himself a good Muslim, yet he is so racist and killing the Kurds, who are there also Muslim people.
فيه نص بالقرآن بيقول إنما المؤمنون إخوة.
Yeah, it is written our all believers are brothers in our Quran.
كيف هذول بيعتبروا إن أعداء وبدوا
how he called them their enemies and they wanted to erase them from their party.
So معناته ما هو لا مسلم ولا good Muslim.
He's not a good Muslim or he doesn't consider himself a Muslim.
يجي يتعلم من بالهند هون.
Let him learn from India
how the tolerance could be. ففي عداوة فظيعة بين الرئيس أردوغان وبين أي كردي بالعالم.
So he is against any Kurdish in the world. It's not only inside Syria. We didn't have a problem with the Kurds inside Syria, by the
way. Get married with a Kurdish one, lady. So in Syria we have no any problem. A lot of president of government in Syria were Kurdish. No any problem.
لازم يبقى تدخلوا اللاجئين من تركيا.
The problem here, Turkey, and then بعدين صار فيه North Iraq. Some problem of that. على كل حال نحن ضد أي شكل من أشكال العنصرية على الأطلاق.
We are against any kind of racism. We don't believe in racist behavior by any way.
May I add just a few words, you know, about Erdogan and Turkey and so on, you know, with his recent move under the pretext of Turkish national security. Just let's contemplate and think. Does not every country has to worry about its national security. According to international law, this is a Syrian land. And what happened is an aggression. And it is the right of everybody, of every sovereign state, to defend its right. But has anybody asked why Turkey has bases, 35,000 soldiers in Qatar? Qatar. Does Qatar constitute for the place? Or in Somalia, or in Djibouti, or, you know, in the African Horn. So what type of insecurity that area costs to the national security of Turkey? That is only this ambitious, you know, Erdogan, who really think that he is the caliph and he would be over there in that region, you know, and see how sensitive and strategic that area is. You know, does it mean that he will occupy and engulf Mecca, for example, to be the real caliph in that region, or Yemen, or that oil? Now, as a matter of fact, when I was in my position, I met Erdogan during the official visit, more than 5, 6, 7, 10 times, I don't know. Believe me, I have
before
never...
Before 2011. Before 2011. Before.
Yes, of course. Mm. That was, I never saw him smiling. I never saw his teeth. Now we see his teeth biting. You know, biting humanity. And imagine this is 171,000 foreign fighters entered Syria. Is that a revolution? Syrian revolution. To enter Syria from every nook and corner, just to destroy every civilization. And this reminds, really, of the 30 years war in Europe. This, now it is being history as if it is repeating itself, you know. Now, why we come to India, it is actually, I should congratulate the organizers for this Dynamics of Bilateral Engagement. You know, if one looks at India, yes, 4Ds, which everybody, I believe, know, which is democracy, coexistence, diversity, you know, which is quite very important, development, and your words, dynamics. So this dynamics and diversity and development to which the Syrian people looks towards Syria is the right place that India, yes, can play a role. Especially, and it has already played, is playing. I have been here, you know, last year, our ambassador, Dr. Riyad, through, you know, his efforts and so on, has really found and received a very, very important move by the Indian government to win almost 1,000 scholarships. Just for your information, if you remember the Chile boys, which the Americans sent to Chile to learn and so on, and they came back. Our government, Your Excellency, our government has refused 500 scholarships from Hungary. And when, for why they wanted it, you know, but when the Indians, 1,000, yes, let's go, and we need another 1,000, you know, that is why we care for India. Thank you.
Thank you.
I'd like to first ask the Ambassador Haran. Incidentally, Ambassador Haran was the ambassador of India in
Damascus
Syria at the time of in 2011, when the first disturbances broke out in Syria after the Arab Spring, and also this was a period when India was actually a member of the elected member of the Security Council. So he had a very ringside view on the developments in Syria at that time.
Very good.
I'll ask Ambassador Haran and then perhaps you. And I also noticed some very senior journalists, Shubha and Cherian. Cherian, I know you've been traveling in Syria and so on. So in case you would like
to ask. Ahlan.
Thank you, Muko. I'm Haran, retired diplomat. Two short questions. One is, you mentioned that there were terrorists from various countries who were there in Syria. Was there anybody from India there? Second, has the government forces moved into the province of Asake, particularly the towns of Asake and Kamishli?
نحن على كل حال, we didn't mention ولا مرة لا بالوسائل الإعلام تبعيتنا ولا بالتلفزيون ولا بشيء أنه عن وجود أي واحد هندي كان بيننا.
We never even mentioned once in our.
إذا كان موجود فعلاً.
Even if we have captured Indian terrorist inside Syria, we never mention it publicly to anybody because we do not want it to give this dark image, because Indian, they don't represent the whole of India.
Yes.
عن مناطق الشمالية الشرقية من سوريا مناطق الوجود الأمريكي فيها يعني.
هلا الأمريكان
لوين وصلت القوات السورية ولوين هن موجود؟ يعني تعطي شوي.
القوات السورية موجودة بكل الشمال إلا على موضوع البير النفط وال.
Syrian troops have reached to the border with Turkey.
أمريكي.
They are already on the border, except for Deir ez-Zor, where the oil, where the American redeployed their forces near to the oil refineries. Yes.
يعني تصور إنه الرئيس رئيس الولايات المتحدة الأمريكية ترامب يتغزل بالبترول السوري إنه how much nice و transparent بطيء عن هذا يعني
بتلا he's saying it's a gimmick يعني a superpower like the United States a president is he's gaining and lustered about capturing the Syrian oil which doesn't give him a petty money not more than their $35 million per month and he's saying we are going to send American company to explore and take the Syrian oil
يعني مثل الصياد اللي بيصيد هال innocent birds وبيتغزل فيه انه هني ميتين
so it's like hunter he's hunting and capturing the Syrian oil like we used to see in Indian American movie cowboy it's a daylight looting now
عفوا
good evening everyone I am Sanya Rizwan from Lady Shriram College from the youth led organization that Anushka just mentioned so my question is we acknowledge today the role of United States in the condition of Syria and their actions towards Syria in that condition what do you expect or rather what do you hope that the international community's stance placed regarding USA should be and their actions
شوف الدور الدول العالم المجتمع الدولي
نحن نطلب من الأمم المتحدة والمجلس الأمن أن يطلب إلى كل المحتلين أيا كانوا أن يمشوا من بلد
appeal and we asked the United the international community to put pressure on their countries that to adhere to the UN charters that all foreign troops enter into Syria must leave Syria by all means should be out of Syria because they were illegally and uninvited when and unwelcome in Syria they came as an aggressor as an invaders and they should go back
thank you that was a very clear answer Charim
Tafadhal
can the YPG the Syrian Kurds can they be they still seem to be having a very good relation with
still now
yeah with the Americans And what do you think about the special relationship Putin has with Erdogan and with Israel? Israel still keeps on targeting Syrian cities, and only the other day they targeted the Islamic Jihad leader.
أنا بسألك عن موضوع الأكراد وعلاقته مع الحكومة السورية حتى الآن ومع الولايات المتحدة بنفس الوقت.
أنا قبل بنفس اليوم اللي أجيت فيه على الهند العزيزة الصاروخ إسرائيلي ضرب بيت شاب فلسطيني جارنا
سألنا
وبالتالي يعني هذا الاعتداء اعتداء إسرائيلي سافر مدان من كل المنظمات الدولية في العالم المجلس أمن وشرطة
As you know, the Israeli have supported the terrorist organization from day one inside Syria. Then they have been frequently attacking Syrian positions, violating the Syrian sovereignty, and they have done it. And what they have done last one is an absolute, a clear violation and condemned action by the Israelis of attacking a sovereign nation and a person living inside Syria.
نحن عنا أرض محتلة اسمها الجولان. هذه الأرض بكل قرارات الأمم المتحدة وقوانين الأمم المتحدة وقرارات لها أرقام وتواريخ تطلب أو تطلب إلى إسرائيل والقوات الإسرائيلية بالانسحاب من كل سنتيمتر من الجولان المحتل.
We have territories occupied by Israel, which is the Golan, as you know. And it, by all the International Security Council resolution, UN Security Council resolution, and international law, recognize it as an occupied territories. And we all know that this territories, Israel has to give it back to Syria. So that is why Israel is taking full advantage of the war on Syria, by the way.
نحن نطلب يعني إلى كل أعضاء مجلس الأمن الدائمين وغير الدائمين.
So we are simply asking the members and non-permanent member and non-permanent member of the Security Council, including all the members of the United Nations, that we should adhere to the UN Security Council in this regard.
And دور الروسي ليش الروسي علاقته مع تركيا وعلاقته مع اسرائيل يعني
احنا ما بيهمنا علاقه الروس مع اي بلد اخر الا بعدنا نحن نحن روسيا دوله صديقه ولما طلبنا منها المساعده فقد فعلت ونحن نشكرها جدا اما تعمل علاقات مع البلد يا هي دوله عظمى وعضو دائم بمجلس الامن فهي حره
as you know Russia have played a vital role inside Syria in 2015 when the Syria invited the Russian to take part to support the Syrian government so therefore we have full trust in the Russian position towards Syria and we really respect their relation with any other country one but in, when it comes to Syrian affairs we know that they are working for the Syrian benefit actually
Two comments and a question. I am the Dean of the Diplomatic Corps in India, Ambassador of Dominican Republic, where we have almost 10% of our population of Lebanese and Syrian descent, so we have a very big synergy with Syrian
you
population.
A very nice country.
He's mad because I was absent, but I had...
One time the speaker of your parliament was Syrian.
Yes, I know. Mm-hmm. We have many ministers of Syrian descent. Yes,
indeed.
And he was foreign minister as well. After yes, that, yes. After you met him, yeah. I have to first of you. I want to reconfirm the position that India has had with Syria because, as the dean, and I have been here 14 years, I have seen the stages where he has gone in India, where the Arab League and a lot of his colleagues from the Arab world isolated him for some time. However, the Indian government has never stopped receiving guests from Syria, where I have been there as dean receiving them, where he has invited them me to his home. I have never seen a change in India's policies towards Syria, so India's solidarity towards Syria. Even though his colleagues from the Arab world have isolated him in Delhi, he's never been isolated by the Indian MEA. So I can vouch for the solidarity India has shown to him, his staff, and his mission. I also want to say that I have personally visited Syria before. I have gone to Aleppo. I cried when I saw the things that were happening in Aleppo because it was one of the most beautiful places I've ever been. I previously was a tourism minister in my country. And my question is there any way of reconstructing Aleppo for future? Is there a vision of how to bring Aleppo to a little bit of what it was before, or is it completely destroyed? And another comment I wanted to say, I saw you were the president of the Cuban Friendship Association, so I think you will learn from the best in resisting international forces and being strong towards the enemy, because we can learn from them. They have been 60 years surviving.
How to be patient.
Patient and surviving through many aggressions from many, many countries. So being the president of the association is very helpful for you and and your country.
Thank you. Thank you. نحن عندنا مدينتين حضاريتين يعني تقريبا destroyed. اللي هن سوق بحمص وسوق بحلب هدول من قبل السيد المسيح
You see, as you know, we have two historical cities in Syria, and Aleppo, considered by Guinness Book of Records, is the oldest city in the world, more than 13,000 years, and not Yemen, as it is Aleppo. And the old market of Aleppo was totally destroyed inside Syria.
ونحن الآن بصدد يعني نوع من المكاشفة مع دول عديدة لها خصوصية بالهندسة المعمارية وشغلات هاي إنه how to rebuild in the same system هالمدينتين هدول.
So Homs City and Aleppo in particular, they have been in touch with different countries in the world who have the architectural structure of the old monuments and which was totally destroyed to rebuild it in the same fashion.
عندنا بالميرا هيدي أخذتها الأمم المتحدة.
And Palmyra was given to the United Nations.
No.
It was even prior to Jesus Christ were built Roman.
So there is hope that it can be.
Yeah. Yes. Heritage the UNESCO. Whole humanity.
Yes. It was taken as a heritage. And by the way, Umayyad Mosque has been rebuilt. The old street, the old market in Aleppo has been totally rebuilt by the Aleppo people who have returned. 1.5 million people came back to Aleppo.
What about air connectivity? Is there still, easily flights to Damascus? Or you still have to go to
Lebanon? I'm from Dimashq, Kuwait.
As you know, we have the Syrian air and coming. He came from Damascus to Kuwait by air.
Yes. لكن عموما نحن خلال هال من 2011 لل 2019 كنا نروح عبر مطار بيروت.
We used to go through Beirut air plane during the crisis.
مع الأسف هلا بيروت المشكلة يعني شغلة كبيرة كمان.
As you know, the flights from Syria and over Syria has been under sanction because and banned to fly. That is why most of the airlines have stopped because the American put pressure to isolate Syria. But most of the country now, like neighboring country, there is a flight coming from Russia, from Iran, and Syrian airlines goes to the neighboring country.
هيدا الميدل إيست يبدو منطقة هامة جدا لكل العالم.
Yeah, geopolitically important of the Middle East of West Asia is a vital for the rest of the world also. Not, it's a global interest there is in this part.
When I came to India, Syrian Arab Airlines used to fly
yes,
to them.
Yes.
I remember.
We had 3 flights per week.
بيروت قديش عانوا يعني بيروت عانوا من 75 لل 95 المطار تبعهم كان مسكر ويجوا لعندنا يروحوا عبر المطار تبعنا هلا صار فايس فيرسا تعطل المطار تبعنا او الطيارات تبعتنا عطلوها هلا بنروح عبر بيروت فيعني كانه هذه المنطقه
See, they have been subjecting this part of the world to many different events, like when the civil war in Lebanon was there from 1975 till 1985, it was all the flight used to come, the Lebanese flight used to take their space from Syria and they fly from Damascus. Now they have put sanction on Syria, so we had the opposite now. Now we go to Beirut and do the same. So always it has been to and fro from there.
يعني أنا مسؤول عن السيكتور تبع الجامعات بسوريا. خاصة والعامة لما تصير الحرب بحلب نجيب طلابنا من حلب نجيب الطلاب عشان يعني من حلب نجيبهم عشان مشان نحميهم تصير المشكلة بحما نجيب من جامعة حما وهكذا يعني الافورتس اللي عملوها الشعب السوري عن جد كانت دروس يتعلموا فيها البشرية.
قصدوا على الطيران الدولي المعصوم فوق سوريا.
إنه نحن كيف العبقرية السورية إنه تتهدم مدينة تتهدم جامعة نجيب طلابها لجامعة أخرى وهكذا صرنا نعمل تنقلات بشكل إنه كان فيه Syrian ability عجيب وغريب.
So because they have closed our space, we have used the Syrian domestic flight to utilize it for our student and for their teaching. Like suppose they destroyed homes, we used to take them in flight to the student to Damascus to give their exam and to bring them back. And from Aleppo the same and vice versa. And even we used to parachute the books and the curriculum and the exam paper in Raqqa and Hasaka. We used to parachute it and people could give the exam and we used to take them back to.
That just shows the importance you give to education. No?
Yes, this is very important.
Exactly.
We never stopped for a day the education in Syria, even under Daesh, Raqqa, the student, the government employee were getting their salaries.
Thank you.
Well, firstly, my sincere apologies, Excellency, as the Dean of the Diplomatic Corps, not to have. And the Serbian. Ah, hello. How are you, Vlad? Yes, how do you know?
You were not aware who was.
My apologies. And of course, thank you very much for your very valuable contribution and adding to the discussion. May I just conclude this thing with a couple of very small observations? I think, Excellency, one point that you made about Syria as a pluralist society, multi religious.
And you know that?
Yes, we know that. And in fact, I would like to underline it because this is a country that may be, a very large proportion Sunni,
but it also has a very high proportion of Shia, Alawite, Druze, Ismaili,
Christian.
Within the Christians, they have the Orthodox, several denominations of and Orthodox Catholic. Christians, and several denominations of, you know, some say Reformist Christians as well.
Yes.
And at least at the time that I was there, and I think that still holds today, at no point in the Syrian conflict did the struggle and fight and combat against extremism and terrorism degenerate into any form of sectarian conflict. You know, this is a very huge achievement in a country that is a virtual tapestry of different ethnic groups, some Orthodox, some Reformist, and some even heterodox,
yes,
who don't quite fit into any particular, you know, framework of established religion. So I think this is a tremendous achievement. I think the second is, I think very clearly what comes out is the sense of resilience, the spirit of resilience, the fact that Syria is an old country. It's a country that has survived perhaps the greatest national challenge that any country has survived. When other countries have fallen by the wayside, Syria has survived and come out triumphant. And I'm sure, and I can assure you, that you have the backing of the Indian people and very much of the government of India, and we are very happy to know about the meetings that you had yesterday with our leadership, that you have the government of India to recover the territorial integrity and sovereignty of Syria in full, and to be able to, you know, reconstruct Syria in future. We are very happy, we are very proud that the government of India has backed that reconstruction effort, first of all, in the form of the scholarships, because this is invaluable. This is a kind of intangible contribution to the reconstruction of Syria. And we certainly hope that our ongoing, you know, partnerships in Tishreen and the Hama steel factory, as well as the humanitarian assistance that we have given in the past, and whatever else we can do in the area of oil and natural gas, phosphates, but even other forms of industry through improvement of trade, that we'll be able to strengthen, in fact, our relations as Syria reconstructs to even a stronger and better relationship than ever before.
With your help.
Of course, and I think we have your, you have an assurance of that. So I'd like to thank, first of all the guests present here for making this a very stimulating discussion, all the very fine questions that were asked. Most of all, Excellency, you, for a very passionate and spirited account. Now you understand why I said he was a very popular Minister of Culture. And of course, I cannot but thank Nutan and Somin Bakshi, who were here, the Director General of ICWA, who is not present here, Mr. Raghavan, former High Commissioner to Pakistan, and also a historian in his own right, fellow colleagues and diplomats from friendly countries, and our fellow ambassadors, and most of all, the long-serving Syrian ambassador.
Almost a dean. Three more.
He is competing you.
He's so, almost a dean.
So you're all invited for a cup of tea and refreshments, I think, at the corridor. And once again, thank you.
Thank you.
Luton.
Shukra. Thank you.
Thank you.
Thank you.
I'm very sorry to
you.
Now we finish.
She told me. She was welcome.